Cloudflare, oh Cloudflare. The other day, they had another outage, and as Rust couldn't be blamed this time, because it wasn't even remotely related in this case, and the fact that it lasted about 25 minutes, and also it not being an entire network outage, this time it didn't get anywhere near as much coverage. But it does seem to highlight a problem that Cloudflare has with deploying solutions, because this time, like last time, it's tied to code that wasn't properly tested before doing a wide deployment. As with most Cloudflare outages, there is a blog post on the matter, Cloudflare outage on December 5th, 2025. This began at 8:47 UTC and then ended at 9:12 UTC. This is 25 minutes apart. A subset of customers were impacted, accounting for approximately 28% of all HTTP traffic served by Cloudflare. This is due to the fact that it wasn't just a single thing going wrong, it was a single thing going wrong, and then some other things being set alongside it. And also, like last time, this was not any sort of cyber attack or anything like that. Well, you might call it a cyber attack by their engineers who keep pushing broken code, but it wasn't an external attack. This was entirely a problem caused within Cloudflare. Now, this happened whilst they were trying to mitigate a vulnerability in React server components. This was disclosed last week, and this was a really, really bad vulnerability. So here we have the CVE page, CVE-2025-55182. It was given a 10 by Facebook. Now, NVD didn't give it a score because they've not yet assessed it, but Facebook, the creators of React, were like, this is really bad. We need to fix this. There was also a duplicate made for Next.js, but because it's a duplicate of the same CVE, it doesn't make any sense to report it for both of them. You have the CVE right here. Now, this was so bad because it allowed an attacker to send a request and run arbitrary code. Anytime that's involved is really, really bad. And it's especially bad when it's React. And React is on millions upon millions of websites out there. So, you know, not exactly a problem you want to have. So this is one of those cases where I do think 10.0 probably is pretty fair. This is the graph of HTTP 500 errors. So the green line is the not errors, the 500 is the bad, the errors. And, well, you don't generally want to see this. Now, of course, it is nowhere near as bad as what we saw back in November, where the line was up here and nothing worked. Most things remained working. It was a fairly short-lived issue, and even the sites that were affected, for the most part, weren't entirely taken down. Cloudflare's Web Application Firewall, WAF, remember this, this will be important for later, provides customers with protection against malicious payloads, allowing them to be detected and blocked. To do this, Cloudflare's proxy buffers HTTP request body content in memory for analysis. This was previously set to 128 kilobytes. Now, as a protection against that vulnerability, the buffer size was increased to 1 megabyte, the default limit allowed by Next.js applications, to make sure as many customers as possible were protected. Now, they realized during their gradual deployment that something was not correct. Their internal WAF testing tool did not support the increased buffer size, but as the tool was not actually needed at the time, it was just disabled as it had no effect on customer traffic. However, when you start disabling things because they're causing issues, maybe instead of disabling it because it caused an issue, you stop it causing an issue. Because when they did that, this wasn't deployed with their gradual deployment system. Instead, it was done with the global configuration system. The gradual deployment system gradually rolls out a change to the network, the global configuration system does it as soon as possible. And this system is still under review following the outage on November 18th. This is the prior outage I talked about. This is the one where everybody was blaming Rust for a thing that Rust didn't actually cause because morons didn't read the post. Unfortunately, in our FL1 version of the proxy, that proxy is what was mentioned over in this. That is a system known as Frontline. It is basically the thing that is first hit as traffic goes into Cloudflare that is then routed around the network. FL1 is the old version, FL2 is the new version. FL2 is the one that was written in Rust. Anyway, unfortunately in the FL1 version of our proxy, under certain circumstances, the second change of turning off our WAF rule testing tool caused an error state that resulted in 500 HTTP error codes to be served from our network. As soon as the change propagated to our network, code execution in our FL1 proxy reached a bug in our rules module, which led to the following Lua exception. Failed to run module rule set, callback, and then all of this. Okay, that's horrible to highlight. All of this stuff here. So customers that have their web assets served by our older FL1 proxy and had the Cloudflare managed rule set deployed were impacted. All requests for websites in this state returned an HTTP 500 error, with the small exception of some test endpoints. Customers that did not have this configuration above applied were not impacted, and customers on their China network were also not impacted. I'm not entirely sure what they're doing in China. I assume they have some different tech stack deployed, or I don't know. Is Cloudflare managed by a different entity within China? I'm actually not sure. Cloudflare's rule set system consists of a set of rules which are evaluated for each request entering our system. A rule consists of a filter which selects some traffic and an action which applies an effect to that traffic. Typical actions are block, log, or skip. Another type, and this one is important to the issue here, is execute, which is used to trigger evaluation of another rule set. Our internal logging system uses this feature to evaluate new rules before we make them available to the public. A top-level rule set will execute another rule set containing test rules. It was these test rules that we were attempting to disable. However, they do have this kill switch for a rule, but a kill switch with the execute action was never actually properly tested. When the kill switch was applied, the code correctly skipped the evaluation of the execute action and didn't evaluate the subrule set pointed to by it. However, an error was then encountered while processing the overall results of evaluating the rule set. This code expects if the rule set has action execute, then rule result.execute object will exist. This object did not exist, and then Lua returned an error due to attempt to look up a null value. So basically the issue is we have a function that has the ability to return a null, but it being able to return a null isn't something that was intended and was not something that was documented. This is a straightforward error in the code, which had existed undetected for many years. This type of code error is prevented by languages with strong type systems. In our replacement for this code in the FL2 proxy, which is written in Rust, the error did not occur, because if something can return an empty value, a non-existent value, this is something explicitly documented in the code, and if it's not documented, the code doesn't compile. This is why the Rust people are not talking about it. Because this is explicitly a case where a strong type system, not just Rust, but a strong type system, makes a problem like this not possible. Now, all of this raises some pretty concerning things with Cloudflare, with how they're deploying changes. Like, what are you doing, right? You had a massive outage 2 weeks ago. You have another outage, less massive, but still, and it's caused by not testing your problems. It's caused by deploying things in a way that don't make any sense. There was never a reason to go and disable the testing tool. If the testing tool doesn't work, that indicates there's probably other areas of your system that also do not work when you go and make this change. What are you doing? Genuinely, what are the engineers at Cloudflare doing? What sort of development practices do you have that you let this happen twice in 2 weeks? What about the changes being made after the incident on November 18, 2025? We have spoken directly with hundreds of customers following that incident, and we shared plans to make changes to prevent single updates from causing widespread impact like this. We believe these changes would have helped prevent the impact of today's incident, but unfortunately, we've not actually deployed them yet. We're not finished deploying them yet. Maybe, okay, maybe there should be some sort of, I don't know, chain of command when a change is deployed, and there shouldn't just be, oh, we're just gonna disable this thing, and if it breaks, who cares? We'll deal with it later. It's probably gonna be fine. And they list out a bunch of things they're gonna do to supposedly fix these problems. Enhanced rollouts and versioning. Yeah, that's probably something you should be done. Streamlined break glass capabilities and fail open error handling. All that stuff sounds great, assuming it actually happens. Before the end of next week, we will publish a detailed breakdown of all the resiliency projects underway, including the ones listed above. While the work is underway, we are locking down all changes to our network in order to ensure we have better mitigation and rollback systems before we begin again. That should have been done with the last outage, not done now. Obviously, yeah, like the vulnerability is massive and all that good stuff. But like, how do you let two massive outages happen in 2 weeks? These kinds of incidents and how closely they are clustered together are not acceptable for a network like ours. On behalf of the team at Cloudflare, we want to apologize for the impact and pain this has caused again to our customers and internet as a whole. This feels like it was written by the PR department. This is all written by, like, you know, engineers, and here's how the problem actually happened. And then it's like, oh, PR department, you guys can take over from here. I don't know what is happening at Cloudflare, and I'm sure someone's gonna take the day off around Christmas. So what's your bet? How much do you want to bet that even though they say they're pausing changes, there's going to be at least one more outage this December? We'll have to wait and see on that front. I will be waiting with bated breath because it certainly wouldn't surprise me. So, let me know your thoughts down below. At this point, what do you honestly think Cloudflare is doing? Because I certainly have no idea. Anyway, if you like the video, go like the video. Go subscribe as well. If you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, Stelly Barabay, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and I don't know, man.